10 years ago, Steve Gleason was an overachiever, just trying to make it in the NFL.
I'm just kind of a regular dude.
10 years later, the storyline has changed many times over. The blocked punt, the statue, the diagnosis.
They could have told me anything at that diagnosis. I would have not listened. I didn't think that he was going to get sick. I didn't think that they were right.
The overachiever becomes a hero. Twice.
We all face tragedy and adversity, but most often, that is where we find our power and meaning.
From football, to ALS, to the Sundance Film Festival, and adventures still undiscovered, this is Steve Gleason, The Journey. Welcome to Park City, Utah, where the latest chapter in Steve Gleason's years-long battle with ALS has been written. And this certainly won't be the last chapter on this very unexpected journey, as Steve lives by his mantra, awesome ain't easy. So how did we get here to the Sundance Film Festival in 2016? Let's take a look back at the path that got us here. Spokane, Washington, and New Orleans, Louisiana. They are thousands of miles and, in many ways, worlds apart. This is Steve Gleason's first home, born and raised in the shadow of imposing mountains. He played college football and baseball at Washington State University, and though he would set records on the diamond that still stand and start at linebacker in the Rose Bowl, Gleason struggled to go pro. He wasn't selected in the NFL draft, and he found his way to the New Orleans Saints almost by accident. In 2000, the Indianapolis Colts signed Gleason as a free agent, then, in a serendipitous move, released him during the preseason. The Saints added Gleason to their practice squad and, well, you know the rest of the story.
Katrina could not blow it out. Katrina could not drown it. It's back, leading the way for a city, a state, and a region that will be back too.
In 2006, Gleason cemented himself in Saints history by authoring one of the franchise's greatest plays. It was September 25th. The Louisiana Superdome was hosting its first football game since Hurricane Katrina tore the roof apart 13 months earlier, and the Saints' first home game period in nearly 21 months. It was also the first home game for new head coach Sean Payton. Across the field, the arch-rival Atlanta Falcons. The stage was set for something great.
Here's Kane and Payton! It is going to be covered by the Saints for a touchdown!
A block heard around the sports world. So big then, but who would have imagined just how big later, that it was the launching point for a man who would keep overachieving, a man who would keep breaking through obstacles. Gleason was a player whose impact came on special teams, contributing in any way he could. He played for the Saints for one more season, his seventh in black and gold. 2 years removed from the game, Gleason watched his teammates celebrate the franchise's first ever championship. He was such a part of the team's resurgence, they honored him with a Super Bowl ring. By then, there had been a change in Steve Gleason. He had been diagnosed with ALS, and now the man who once carried a city on his back would turn to others for support in ways he would never have imagined. And yet Steve was about to make his most indelible mark on those who knew him, or watched him, or in countless instances, on those who, until now, had never even heard of him. At the age of 34, Steve Gleason was diagnosed with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease. More than 6,000 people receive the same diagnosis each year. ALS is a neuromuscular disease. It causes muscle weakness and impacts physical function. Eventually, it affects the patient's ability to control the muscles needed to move, speak, eat, and even breathe. There is no cure for ALS, and it is usually fatal within 5 years. I visited Steve at his home in May of 2015 for an up-close look at his daily struggles. Just getting ready for the day can take 90 minutes, but Gleason, who embraces technology, refuses to let ALS take over.
When I choose to see my situation as an opportunity, the rewards are incredible. I know that I am helping inspire people with disabilities, and even people without disabilities. All people search for meaning and purpose in life.
In a quest to fulfill his purpose, Steve meets regularly with engineers from Microsoft to improve the tablet attached to his wheelchair, the wheelchair that drives his life. Steve's home is fully automated. Just about everything he needs to use is controlled by his eyes. He tweets, listens to music, watches videos, and surfs the internet. His customized wheelchair keeps him moving. His tablet keeps him going. but he still does need help with everything.
Everything means brushing my teeth, showering, feeding me, adjusting a finger, or scratching my nose. Literally, everything. We have worked hard to try and replace the things that I used to love to do with new, meaningful activities.
What he's done is to go out and show that he's able to exhibit his voice because of the speech-generating device that he has.
In July of last year, just 2 months after our interview, Congress passed the Steve Gleason Act. President Obama signed the legislation into law, making technology like Steve's available to ALS patients through Medicare and Medicaid.
All these devices are very expensive. So without Medicare, the average person wouldn't be able to afford.
Steve's fight against ALS began in January of 2011. His wife, Michelle, found out she was pregnant with their first child the following month. Steve knew what was ahead. He started work on a video project for his then unborn son, Rivers, recording as much of himself as he could while he was still able to speak, leaving words of wisdom for Rivers that he could draw on throughout his life in the event that Steve was not there.
I love you, Rivers, and I love your mama. From my wheelchair, from my bed, or from the stars, I love you forever.
Born from Steve's 1,300 hours of video came a project no one expected. A project that started as something so deeply personal, a journal from a father to his son, turned out to be a vehicle for ALS awareness, something for the world to embrace. It's an up-close look at the rapid deterioration of a professional athlete, the rewriting of a newly married couple's life dreams, and their struggle to cope with the diagnosis while also preparing to welcome a baby into the world. And that brings us back here to Park City, Utah and the Sundance Film Festival. Back in December, Steve Gleason's feature-length film titled Simply Gleason was accepted into this year's festival, one of just about 200 out of about 9,000 submissions. The night before the world premiere at a private screening for family and friends, Steve talked about what this film means to him.
The project has evolved into something much bigger, but it started innocently enough as a way to share myself with our son Rivers. Ultimately, if you walk away from this film with anything, my hope is you understand that in the midst of adversity, we will find our greatest opportunities. We all face tragedy and adversity, but most often, that is where we find our power and meaning.
Like Gleason himself, Park City, Utah has seen fame in two forms, the renowned ski hamlet, and now celebrated for its film festival as well. Sundance has grown to become the largest independent film event in the United States. The picturesque town nestled in the Wasatch Mountain Range sits around 7,000 feet above sea level, offering breathtaking views to those who visit from around the globe. They come to challenge the same slopes that tested the world's best at the 2002 Winter Olympics. But the biggest single draw is the Sundance Film Festival, with its estimated 40,000 visitors pumping $80 million annually into the local economy. For 10 days, Park City becomes the place to be for the film industry. Celebrities are everywhere, with blogs tracking sightings and sharing selfies. This year, Steve Gleason was poised to grab the spotlight. The film about his battle with ALS is raw, powerful, and emotional, lifting the audience up while tearing it down, teaching unexpected lessons. It is real life with ALS, an unvarnished look inside Steve's daily struggles and those of his wife, Michelle. Gleason director Clay Tweel made his second consecutive appearance at Sundance after last year's breakout film, Finders Keepers.
And this project meant a lot to me. I feel like the experience of trying to make this movie has shed a lot of new light on kind of like the perspective that I have and take in a day-to-day basis of like, what is actually important, you know, having some perspective and having really like a sense of renewed hope in the human spirit, because that's what Steve and Michelle are all about. And their story and their strength is so palpable. It's hard to not come away with that.
One of the film's producers, Kimmy Culp, pointed to Steve's willingness to put everything out there for the world to see.
It's yet again bravery and courage and being brave enough to be that vulnerable and opening yourself up to inspire other people. So, it's really exciting, and I think it's a great new platform for Steve. He shared his story with so many, and I think this will just help continue to amplify that.
A few days before his trek to Park City, Steve was promoting the film, tweeting, "We all have a timeline. Most of us don't live like we have a timeline. And the journey is in the journals." Then, the day before the world premiere, hold on to your blank, America. He was ready. The New York Times called Gleason one of the 10 Sundance films with heat and wrote, "Prepare to be wrecked." That is no overstatement. The night before the Sundance world premiere in late January, several dozen family members and friends and a large contingent from New Orleans converged on Park City.
You know, when Steve started making all of the videos, when he was diagnosed 5 years ago, it was for him and for Rivers, and it's just exploded into something where he wants to share it with the world, and it's an incredible movie. And you know, for all of us to come up here and be able to support Steve, because he's changed our lives, and just like he's changed so many. So everybody's excited and looking forward to it.
That night, everyone boarded a bus to a private screening and celebration at Victory Ranch, 30 miles outside of Park City. Coats were checked, Team Gleason bracelets handed out, and the crowd mingled until showtime. The informal setting gave those who wouldn't be able to get into the sold-out premiere a chance to see the film first.
We have lived the life, and I'm really anxious to see how other people will see this story, this great story of two people and the family. And that'll be the best thing for me, is to see how people relate to it, what they get out of it. And you know, our hope is that we raise more awareness to this dreaded disease.
Among those in attendance, former Saint Scott Fujita, Drew and Brittany Breeze, and Pearl Jam's Mike McCready.
It's amazing to watch. It makes me want to do more with my life.
McCready met Steve about 12 years ago at a Pearl Jam concert, and they hit it off immediately. McCready remembered that Gleason was unassuming, laid back, and in his words, just a cool dude.
He's such an endearing and important person in the history of just people, you know, in terms of people that I've met. I've never met anybody as interesting or as motivated as him. So that's something that I draw myself to.
McCready calls Gleason a high watermark of mankind, showcasing how humans can carry themselves even under the most adverse conditions.
And he's in his wheelchair, he's got ALS, but yet he still keeps fighting for ALS rights, and he goes to the president, and he goes to Microsoft, and he takes the time and his heart and he just does good. And there's no higher honor in my mind to watch somebody do that.
When Sean Payton was hired as the head coach of the New Orleans Saints in January of 2006, after the Katrina-scarred 3-13 season, linebacker Scott Fujita was one of the first players he went after. Payton loved Fujita's heart, fire, and passion, and Fujita bought into Payton's rebuilding vision. Gleason and Fujita got to know each other on that 2006 team, which advanced to the NFC Championship game. Before Gleason blocked that punt, it was Fujita, one play earlier, who sacked Falcons quarterback Michael Vick and forced the ill-fated fourth down kick. Without the sack, the block never happens. The first of many, many assists from Fujita. He considers Steve one of his best friends, is a Team Gleason board member, and has been instrumental in helping raise ALS awareness over the years. When Steve climbed Machu Picchu in Peru of 2013, Fujita was there every step of the way. He is also a co-producer of the film, and says the reason Steve's message has resonated with so many is simply his personality. He says Steve was charismatic before his diagnosis and remains so now.
You could not find a better face, and my hope is that one day when you go on like a Google search and you type in ALS, I mean, Steve Gleason will come up as a guy who single-handedly changed the course of this disease. And it's just having that kind of initiative to go out and say, I'm going to make a difference. You know, for far too long, people with ALS have just faded away quietly and die. I'm not going to be that guy. I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to make an impact.
Well, who would have ever thought that Steve Gleason would be here at Sundance unveiling this documentary that is really going to have an incredible impact on so many people? Who would have thought that Steve Gleason would be up in front of Congress getting bills passed called the Gleason Act to help advance technology and research and provide funding for people with neurological diseases to help improve their quality of life? I mean, who would have thought anybody could accomplish those things, and yet Steve Gleason can, because he's Steve Gleason.
Saints quarterback Drew Brees, also new to the Saints in that memorable 2006 season, was playing his first home game as a Saint when Steve barged onto the national stage. Something about him caught Brees' eye early.
He's one of the greatest people I know. And honestly, from the moment that I first met him and had a chance to be his teammate back in 2006, You just knew there was something different about this guy. He's special, he's unique. He had such a zest for life and for living and for adventure, and it's just such a big heart and a great soul.
When Breeze found out about Steve's ALS diagnosis, he was in Seattle on the team bus heading to play the Seahawks in a playoff game. The news was devastating.
I just remember sitting there speechless for a long period of time, just thinking to myself, of all the people in the world, this is the last guy on earth that would deserve something like this. And yet, I think he's the only guy on earth that would be able to accomplish what he's accomplished through that diagnosis.
Perhaps the most unexpected accomplishment to date is this film, an eye-opener and tearjerker. And yes, the documentary is about ALS and living with the awful disease, but the message reaches far beyond that, especially for someone like Breeze, a father of four.
I think that one of the things that's going to come from this film that, again, was maybe not the intent in the beginning, was I think everyone who's a father, it makes you think long and hard about who you want to be as a father and the legacy that you want to leave for your kids and just how you want to value each and every second you have with them.
Emotions got the best of Drew's wife, Brittany, during the screening. She couldn't help but wonder how she would handle such a devastating life blow.
It's hard to watch. You know, it's hard not to put yourself into his shoes, you know. But at the same time, it makes you want to be a better parent. It makes you value everything that you go through every day. It makes you truly treasure those small moments of being able to hold your child, being able to tell them that you love them, being able to read a book to them every night and to tuck them in. And those are things that he can't do, but he's been able to document that. So it really makes you step back and evaluate how you deal with your children, how you deal with everyday life.
After the screening, Steve Gleason arrived at Victory Ranch, slowly exiting a specially equipped minivan. Inside, after a meet and greet, Steve was ready to share a message with those closest to him.
Steve Gleason is here behind me. He's got a few words he'd like to say, so if we can have silence in the back, please, everybody bring it in as close as possible so he can address the crew. Thank you.
There are so many people to thank for this film, and so many people to thank for tonight's event. I think Michelle and her efforts inspire any woman, mother and caretaker. She's incredible. Both the production team and our film guys have embedded themselves, not just in this project, but they've embedded themselves in our lives. Our hope is that this film changes your perspective on adversity, your perspective on parenting, and your perspective on life. As scary as this entire process is, Michelle and I are very grateful for so many of you in this room and all your hard work.
Through it all, Michelle Gleason has been the rock, who could never have imagined the cruel turn her life with Steve would take. She went from newlywed in 2008 to new mother and caretaker in 2011, a whirlwind of changes in a short time, changes she admits would have been impossible without an incredible support system.
The hardest thing about this whole thing is that I miss Steve. I miss the Steve that I married, and I love the Steve that's here now, but we've had to experience lots of loss of him, and so watching that, and I think, as I said before, I think missing a lot of the key players is a hard thing to watch because I know it's not just us.
She is the heroine in the film, the one who largely avoids the spotlight, balancing tragedy with her biting sense of humor.
We couldn't survive with all the help of the people that we get, of our friends and family, and I think, like, seeing me in terrible outfits and seeing me chunky with short hair and in my underwear in bathroom scenes and wearing Steve's underwear is not easy to watch. And I personally think that they film me from really bad angles. That's not easy to watch. And that bedroom scene is just not easy to watch because it's like, it's just so personal, and then people are gonna watch it. But besides that, I think it's fine.
Michelle says they don't really watch all the footage they've compiled over the years, so the film screening was the first time they'd seen Steve moving and talking in a long while. She says the first few minutes were particularly rough, but she knows at this point the story extends well beyond their emotions.
It's become so much bigger than it began, and I think it's because Steve's story and his message, I think people get really attracted to, and the more and more people got involved, the bigger it got, and I cannot believe that we are here right now. I guess I can, because Steve is grandiose and likes, you know, likes to make a statement, but this is, yeah, this is a big deal, I think. I don't know how big of a deal it is, but I think it's a big deal.
A big deal to say the least. The next day, back in Park City, a surreal scene, or as Michelle called it, unnatural. Steve on the red carpet, Michelle on the red carpet, friends and former teammates. One by one, people stopping to praise Steve and his incredible drive and passion that ultimately produced a film at Sundance.
It's good, it's exciting. It's one of those things, you know, a couple years ago, and you're like, all right, we have a goal of getting into Sundance. You never think in a million years it'll actually happen, but here we are, and it's incredible, and it's just a testament to all the work that's been put into it, and everybody, I think, just leading with their hearts.
That's what's so real about the whole thing, is that everyone in the world is gonna get a chance to see this and learn about Steve and learn about his journey and learn about the person that he is, but also learn about his family and the things that are important to him, and I think that really the things that should be important to all of us in life.
Yeah, the now is the time, and I'm so excited. I'm like, have been dying to get the film in front of what I consider some of the best audiences in the world up here at Sundance, truly. So I'm very excited for the screening, and it's going to be a big crowd and a big day.
For the cinematographers, the duo embedded with Gleason at his home and elsewhere for years, the film went from just another project to something intensely personal.
And we got so close to him, so it was so hard to see him go through some of that stuff and continue the film and be objective about it. So, but I think it turned out pretty good.
What did you learn?
So much, I don't know. How to be a dad, husband, how to keep things in perspective. I don't know, such a long list.
And with Steve Gleason behind the effort, it's a list that will certainly get longer.
He played the game like he lives his life, you know? Just
can we get some individuals of you gentlemen?
Kind of with,
start with you, sir.
I don't want to say like a reckless abandon, but just, you know, like he's all in. He's all in with everything that he does. Whether it is playing the game of football, whether it was running down on a kickoff or blocking a punt, or the way he is with his family, his friends, his just love of adventure, just life, and now the way that he hopes to be able to help others.
The day Gleason premiered, it was the number two trending film at Sundance. The reviews were outstanding.
If I can say anything, it's a true story. It's brutal, but it is what it is. It's the life that they lead. I think people will take a lot of things away from it. One of which is that they'll see the true way that they have to live. They'll see inspiration. You know, they'll get a lot out of this, and that's what I'm excited about. I want to see how people relate to it.
Variety called it an emotional powerhouse of a documentary. From Time Magazine, a movie that will be big in 2016. Another called it an emotional triumph. The buzz was so loud and the reviews so strong, there's already Oscar talk. The week after the premiere, Amazon Studios, with theatrical partner Open Road, announced a deal securing all U.S. rights to Gleason. That means a limited summer release in theaters, including some in the New Orleans area, and streaming availability on Amazon. More challenges conquered by a man who says, I believe my future will be far greater than my past.
I mean, the guy he's amazing, and I think he's on a day-to-day basis an inspirational person. So just in collaborating with him and seeing what he does and how much he achieves despite his limitations, you know, whether it's like communicating about the movie or going out and like giving speeches on his own, it's amazing.
So what is next for Steve Gleason? There's already been The Block, the statue outside the Superdome, the Ice Bucket Challenge, the film at Sundance. No, the next chapter hasn't been written yet, but you can bet it'll certainly be one to remember.
I think that's what you love about being Steve's friend, is you never know what's around the corner, but you know it's gonna be exciting.
Given a diagnosis of just 2 to 5 years to live, and now in year 5, Steve has chosen to live. He refuses to fade away and continues to inspire.
He's destined for greatness, and he's relentless, and he's a special guy. And yeah, there's not that many. I wouldn't want to do that. And there's certain people that can, and he can.
Back home from Sundance, Steve is settling back into his routine, reflecting on the Sundance experience and the validation it brought to Steve and Michelle's decision to share their story.
I think it showed us that this is an important story that is meaningful to not only the ALS community, or football fans, or fathers. The message seemed to be received universally across all audiences. The footage that our little group shot is raw, intimate, alarming, inspiring, heartbreaking, and joyful. Nearly everyone who has seen the film, including me, feels the same emotions that are in the footage.
In a lifetime, not many people are called heroes once. Steve Gleason, though, has been called one twice. First, for The Block, for one moment in time, lifting up a community that so desperately needed it. And now for lifting up another community, those fighting ALS. So what is next for Steve Gleason? Remember, awesome ain't easy.
Mostly, I'm talking to a handful of ALS patients and share with each other our plans to rule the world, with you ordinary people as our underlings. No, in all seriousness, my focus for what is next in life revolves around trying to be the best father and husband that I can possibly be.
Steve Gleason can no longer walk, but no one embraces his path more. He can no longer speak, but his message has never been louder. And he can still tweet, which means he'll always taunt the Atlanta Falcons. In Park City at the Sundance Film Festival with WDSU Chief Photographer Megan Mackle, I'm Scott Walker.